deep sea thing. This is the great privilege that I have looked forward to for some time. I've often heard this Shenandoah Valley and waited with great anticipation for time to come. And with Brother Pittman and Brother Wilson and many of the other ministers that I have met in different parts of the country, I've been invited here for around 7 or 8 years. And tonight to be here, it certainly is a grand privilege. And now we do not want to take too much time, for Mr. Vail and them, they speak in the ministers. And we come to be with you for these 5 days. Wish we could stay longer, just to walk in the building and feel the spirit of the meeting seems to be right at the very first to begin. Oh, I like that. And now it goes to show you've got 5 ministers here that's been teaching you. And with prayer meetings, that's what makes the meeting, is people who are praying. Now, a minister cannot bring a revival himself. It takes God to send a revival, and it takes people, his people, who are willing to congregate themselves together and pray. Then he said, I will hear from heaven if the people that are called by my name shall assemble themselves together and pray. Then he would hear from heaven, and he would heal it. And we know his promises are true. I thought tonight it would be a good time just to get acquainted. Speak of what we are here for, what we stand for, what our purpose is of being here. And then we kind of get acquainted. Tomorrow afternoon is an instruction service. And tomorrow night again, we pray for the sick. We do not think and place all the emphasis on praying for the sick. We pray for the sick just like when you go fishing. You take the bait, but you never show the fish the hook. You just let him see the bait. And when he gets the bait, he gets the hook. So that's what we preach the gospel. We believe first that a man must be born again. He must be born again. And then if he's not born again, then he cannot understand the kingdom of God. Jesus told Nicodemus that. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom. The word see there is the English translation, which really means cannot understand the kingdom of God until he's born again. Now, many of you have read the book of the life story. We don't have any programs to sponsor anything. We don't sell things. Just we have a few books. I think they said they had about 60 or 75, that's all. Because the books are out of print at the time being reprinted. And then they had some of the pictures, which are the angel of the Lord, which will be shown or talked about later. Now, we're not here to represent or to build up any certain denomination of church. We are here to represent a person, and that person is Christ. We're here for a principle, and that's for his principle. We come to greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus. We're not against any denomination. We are for all denominations, regardless of what creed or color. We stand for all denominations, but no certain one. So therefore, it's a union meeting. Everybody can feel good to come. Not in a church, in an auditorium like this, or just a little basketball room, and anybody can come. Everybody's welcome. Protestant, Catholic, Jew, atheist, infidel, anybody wants to come can come right ahead. They're all welcome. Now, divine healing. Most of the time people think that we are here to represent divine healing. No, we're here to represent the divine healer, Christ, not divine healing. And there is no power in myself or any other man that can heal you. God has never given man power to heal another. What the healing is faith in the finished work that Christ did for his church at Calvary. It is something that's already been finished. It isn't power given unto man. It's power in a faith in what has already been appropriated for the church. salvation. Salvation is first. And salvation, you say, I might ask tonight, how many have been saved 2 years? Many hands would go up. How many have been saved 6 months? Perhaps many hands would go up 6 months ago. But you wasn't saved 2 years ago or 6 months ago. You were saved 1900 years ago when Christ died at Calvary. You just accepted it. Your personal faith accepted it 2 years ago and 6 months ago. He was wounded for our transgressions. With his stripes we were healed. It's faith in a finished work. Some men have faith as ministers. We believe that God has set his church, and in his church he set gifts in his church to bring his church together, to keep it coordinated, and to work for the good of his church. We believe that there are five gifts, ministerial gifts, in the body. That's prophets, or apostles, prophets, teachers, evangelists, and pastors. Then gifts and callings are without repentance. In the local body, there's nine spiritual gifts that operate through the entire body, anywhere, on any of the people that's in this body of the church. I know that sounds maybe to some of you people, that may be something new to you, but it's the scripture, it's a promise that the Almighty God made, and he keeps his ever promise. In the time of the meeting, if I ever say anything, or any of my co-workers says anything you're teaching that's not found in this Bible, you let me know about it. This is the truth, God's Word. Now, God can do things that's not written in the Bible, but yet we believe that this is God's program, the Bible. Now, any of you teachers, especially of the Paul Sisters and Ministerial Group, in here you'll find teachers comparing this. In the Old Testament, they had two ways of knowing whether a man was telling the truth or not. That was, they had a dreamer or a prophet, and if the dreamer dreamed a dream or the prophet prophesied, if it was a little written down, they take him down to the temple and they had what is known as Urim Thummim. What that was the breastplate that Aaron wore. He had all 12 tribes of Israel's birthstone on his breast. And then when the prophet prophesied, and if that light didn't make a conglomeration of light that reflected supernatural, then no matter how true the prophecy seemed to be, it was wrong. And no matter how real the dream seemed to be, it was wrong, because God refused it. The Urim Thummim was the showdown, the supernatural answering back to the prophet. Now, that priesthood was done away with. Aaronic priesthood, Levitical priesthood. But now God has a new priesthood, and he has a new Urim Thummim. This is it, the Bible. If in here, it must come from the Bible. Our teachings and everything must be the action of the Holy Spirit according to the Bible. I have never seen the Holy Spirit at any time in my ministry. I was ordained in the Missionary Baptist Church 27 years ago. And I have never belonged to any other church but the Missionary Baptist Church. I don't belong to any. Wasn't put out. I just walked out to be free in order to put my arms around the whole body of Christ and say, we're one. We are one. Jesus died for that principle, that we might be one. And this will all men know that you're my disciples when you have love one for the other. And my many times around the world, and in the mission fields of seeing our Lord. I've seen in South Africa just recently 30,000 raw heathens come to Christ at one altar call. 30,000. There's about every 200,000 there. Bombay, India just recently, where we had around 500,000, there's no way to estimate how many come to Christ at one time. I believe that we are now living in the last days. I believe that this is the last message, this message of grace that God has given to his church. And I believe at any time, Christ is coming. That's why I'm here tonight, trying my best to call to every side of the world and all that I can do to let people see that he is the true and living God. And if he is the only door, the only religion out of the thousands of religions in the world, Christian religion is the only one that can prove that their founder is still alive. I've stood with the greatest religion in the world, Muhammad, we all know that. Second is Buddha. Third is Christianity, that's Catholic, Protestant, all together. And I've stood with the Bible in one hand, with the Koran together, and challenged tens of thousands of Muhammadans and all together. Let the God that is God speak. Nothing to be ashamed of in Christianity. If this isn't the truth, then I'm through with it. If this is the truth, I won't. It's the biggest error the world ever had. But if it is the truth, then I'm willing to die for it. And I have found that every word is the truth. There's no shadow of doubt in my mind. That's the reason it would be easier for me tonight. I don't come for popularity. That's one thing I never want. I don't want to be popular. I want to be honest. And it's not money. Anyone who's ever been in my meetings knows, do not let them beg, bum money, no word at all, no sir. I just won't stand still for that at all. They pay the expenses of the meeting and that settles it. At the end of the meeting, they give me a love offering. If the expenses is paid, that goes right into that. If there's anything left over my love offering, which there hasn't been for a long time, but if there's anything left over, it goes right straight to the mission field to go to work for God, just as quick as it can go. We have no money. We're not here for your money. No, sir. I'm here for one purpose. That's to help you. And you help me. And we're here together to glorify God's beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And now, tonight, I thought I'd kind of give you a little outline of what we believe. Now, first, I want to say that usually in the meeting, we give out prayer cards. If Dr. Dale hasn't already went through this, he said he hasn't. Now, when we first started, I was just lining the people up, and it was like the people getting this side couldn't get the line. So you couldn't have that. It's not an arena, it's a church. It might be an arena international, but we're using it for a church. This is a scramble. Then I let all the cooperating ministers, which I see here tonight, looks like the group here, there's at least 25 ministers, I guess, cooperating, maybe more. At least 50 of them. Now, if I give each one of those ministers 100 cards, who's going to get their group up here first? Well, the group that gets up here, that's going to settle the whole meeting. Then what's the other minister going to do? Then that calls feelings between the ministers. Then I send some men down to pass out the prayer card, and I caught one selling a prayer card. That settled that. Then I put my son in for him to get out the prayer card, for I knew he wouldn't. Or my friend here, Leo Mercer, or Gene Gold, which are my tape boys, and any of them can get out cards. Otherwise, well, I had a minister that his own denomination, but he had full strings. These strings, but he had to do it. So then I took my own son. You get out the cards, this little square card with a number on it. You can take it and be lined up according to the number. And then we have this. If they give them out a number of past 25 or 30, they throw it on the floor. We don't want that. It won't be called. Well, then what I would do, I'd have some little child was sitting up in front. I'd say, how far can you count? And he'd come here. You start counting where he ended off, or she. Then I started from there. Believe it or not, Mommy had a junior to come out of there and stop at her number. So, see, it's just a human element. You get it. So then, here's the way we do it. We come down. Then, we started going down and giving out the entire, all the prayer cards we'd ever get out the first day. If somebody come in late, or come in the second day, there's no need coming. If you wasn't there the first day, you couldn't get a prayer card. So what we do each day, we get out so many cards. From that night, no one, the boys you were giving them out, no one else. They bring them right down here before you, mix them all up together, and you can have maybe this one number one, and next you get number 30, number 60 or 90, something like that. Then no one knows where they're to start from. That night, I just wait till the Holy Spirit tells me, then I'll start and call a few from the platform. And then we start praying for them. Then as soon as the Holy Spirit starts the work, as many of you have been in the meeting, well then, it moves to the audience everywhere. The way the people are, they're sick and afflicted, and they're healed by their own personal faith in Christ. Nothing I have in myself to do it. I'm just your brother. That's all. But Christ, their faith in Christ does the healing. And now, each evening, or each day, then cards will be given out. Each day fresh. And then sometimes when we get a lot of cards out, we'll have a line, get our ministering brothers to line up lines and pray for the sick, all of us, and we take up the cards and just show you that God hears any minister's prayer, anybody's prayer. Don't have to be a minister. You can pray for the sick. God will honor your prayer. See, what it is a faith in the finished work of the Lord Jesus. Today we hear so much about healing. And there's so much difference. You can hear the medical doctor say about the surgeon. Now, we have nothing against doctors, operations, or anything. Not at all. I'm not here to take the doctor's place. I'm here to pray for it. Doctor, if you're here, I'm here to pray for your patient. My friend, God's child. And we're not here to take your patient. And here we find that the doctor, the medical doctor will say, well, don't you go over to that surgeon. He's just a big old butcher. You just cut his pieces. You don't need that. All you need is some medicine. Go over to the surgeon. You don't need sugar pills. You need an operation. The chiropractor will say, the both doctors will say, you don't need to go to the chiropractor. The chiropractor will say, not the osteopathic. All of them say, keep away from the preacher. But what is it? It's selfish motive. Exactly. For we know that surgery, medicine, osteopathic, chiropractic, all of it does good. And if man had the right mind, had the right attitude, the right motive, we'd put our arms together and march forward, trying to help our fellow man to have a little more pleasure while he's here on life, to have a good health. The whole group. If it's not one man wanting money for this and one wanting money for that, and if I can operate, if I keep it waiting for operation, or something like that. Now, all doctors don't do that. That's not the attitude of all doctors. They're all chiropractors or so forth. They're all preachers. But I found one thing. I found in my ministry a whole lot more doctors believing divine healing than I have preachers. That's right. That's right. More doctors believe in divine healing and the energy of preachers. Some of them are very, very horrible against it. Well, I've never met an honest doctor. I was interviewed at Mayo Brothers, many great clinics. You can imagine how it is around the world. And I've found very few doctors that didn't believe in divine healing. It's the way it's presented, see? If you present yourself as a healer, the doctor knows that. Now, there's not a medicine in the world can heal you. Now, remember that. There's no medicine, no doctor, no clinic ever heal one person. All healing comes from God. Could you hear that? All healing is from God. I believe that God's word is so infallible that there is not one iota of it that's wrong. Psalm 103:3 said, I'm the Lord who heals all your diseases. If there could be anything else healing you besides God, then God knows something wrong. And remember, when the circumstances arise and the way God acts in that circumstance, he's got to act every time after the same way that he acted in that time, or he acted wrong when he acted then. God doesn't learn more. God's infant. You believe that? Amen. We get smarter. Generations keep getting smarter. But God can. He's perfect to begin with. And if God healed the sick, they were there when they were in the march and the journey, and he haunted up a bright serpent for an atonement, and God made an atonement for the healing then because people were in need, he'd have to do the same thing today, or he acted wrong when he did it there. Right? He could just get more medical knowledge. But he raised up a brass serpent. Now remember, let's see how simple it is. What if I cut my hand tonight with a knife, and I fell down on the platform dead? You take me down to the undertaker establishment, and they embalm my body. Then you'd say, well, that finished your life. Now, there isn't all the medicine in the world could not heal that cut in my hand. A medicine that healed a cut on my hand, but healed a cut on my coat. It healed a cut on that floor. Well, you say, Brother Branham, medicine was made for your coat or that floor. But all right. Now, if I've cut my hand and fell dead, let them give me penicillin and sulfur drugs and visit me, cut an embalming fluid to make me look natural for 50 years, and every day give me a shot of penicillin for 50 more years. And at the end of that 50 years, that cut just the same as it was the day it was cut. Now, if medicine heals the human body, then what will heal it? Well, you say the life is going out of it. That's it. You tell me what life is, I'll tell you who God is. God, medicine doesn't build tissue. Medicine only keeps clean while God builds tissue. What if I was working on my car out there and broke my arm? Now I run into the doctor. I said, Doc, heal my arm right quick. You're a healer. I want you to heal my arm. He'd say, Mr. Brandon, you need dental healing. Well, that's right. Well, now, if he's a healer, why don't he heal my arm? What he does, he sets my arm and God heals. Right. Healing only comes from God. If I cut my hand, the doctor can give me sulfa drugs or he can give me penicillin. And I say, what about penicillin? What about when you got pneumonia? And the doctor gives you penicillin. That doesn't heal you. Certainly not. What is penicillin? Penicillin like rat poison. If you got a house full of rats and they're eating holes through your house and you put out rat poison, that kills the rats but it don't patch the holes. Well, that's what penicillin. It kills the germ, but it doesn't patch your body. God has to create cells again to patch up what the germs is eat out. Absolutely the truth. There is no medicine that can heal. Medicine isn't made to heal. Good doctors tell you that medicine doesn't heal. Medicine, Jimmy Mayo said, on their great clinic, a train up the old place, now this new round of doctors was accepted. But they said that we do not profess to be healers. We only profess to assist nature. There's one healer, that's God. That's true. That's God. So God is the healer, and faith in God is a finished work. Let the doctor give you every much medicine. If you don't believe it's going to help you, you'll be a dead patient pretty soon. It's your faith. You've got to believe. Oh, you can't go home tonight without faith. If you think you can't move and believe it strong enough, you'll sit right there. Right. You've got to believe it. Now, how can I believe it, Brother Brandon? How can I see how I'm going to get well? Here some time ago down in the mountains of Kentucky to where I was born. And then I was talking to a fellow. And he said, Brother Branham, I just can't accept that. He said, I have to see it true before I could accept it. He had a lantern in his hand. Of course, you people up there don't walk the lanterns as they have to up there in those mountains. And so I said, where do you live at? He said, across the mountain about 2 miles. I said, how are you going to get there? It's all for God. He said, I'm taking this lantern. I said, well, then you can't see your house. He said, no. I said, well, how are you going to get there then? What? He said, well, just pack the lantern. I said, that's the same thing you do now. Step in the light, walk with the light, it'll show the road right straight on to deliverance. If you just keep on going. Walk in the light, it is in the light. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Now, I want to take a text from the Scripture. Now, I've got about 20 minutes. I want to take a text from the Scripture, but before we open this blessed holy word, let's speak to the author. Most gracious God, we thank thee tonight for the Lord Jesus who died to be a propitiation for our sins and our sickness. And we thank thee because that he has given us this grand, marvelous privilege of simmering together up here in this great valley with thy people. And we ask that his great presence will be known in our midst night after night as the revival goes on. Grant, Lord, that something will happen that will cause an old-fashioned revival to break out through this country, that tens of thousands of lost souls might be brought into the kingdom of God. Grant that every church that's got an empty seat may be filled after this revival and remain that way until Jesus comes. Let these ministering brethren, shepherds of the flock, we would ask, dear God, that you would just make yourself known to them in a very special way. Bless the laity, the sheep of the fold. Bless every denomination. And now manifest yourself, Lord. And the scripture it is written, faith cometh by hearing, hearing of the word of God. Now we pray that you will speak to us through the word, while we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to read a portion of scripture just by the way to speak to you from the Word for just a few moments before the prayer, just to get you acquainted with the ministry. Now, everyone understands that when the card is to be given out, we're not claiming to be healers. It's your faith in God. All that. Understand that, raise up your hands. That's good. Your personal faith in God. Now, in the book of St. John, the 12th chapter, and the 20th verse, we read this just for a few moments now. We'll take this and get a context, the Lord willing. And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to the worship at the feast. And the same therefore came to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And now for our text, and for our campaign theme, in the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter, the 8th verse, Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday, today, and forever. Now this that I have just read is a portion of God's eternal Word. And heavens and earth shall pass away, but God's Word shall never pass away. It's as eternal as God is eternal. And when His church gets to a place that they can accept His Word upon those principles and those faiths, that God's Word is a part of God. And then His Word, in the beginning, was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So therefore, we have read words that have never an end. As long as there is an eternity, these words shall remain the same. And these hungry Greeks come up with enthusiasm with this remark, Sir, we would see Jesus. And as your brother, I don't believe that there is a man that's in his right mind, or a woman, that ever heard that precious name and know what it meant, or any mental conception of what it meant, but what has desired to see Jesus.
Amen.
If I should ask this audience of people tonight, would you love to see Jesus? Every person here would say, yes. Well, then the Scripture says that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Then why can't we see Jesus? If the Scripture says He is the same, then He's got to remain the same, or the Scripture is not infallible. They just meant it for a certain time. But it isn't so. The Bible says He's the same yesterday, today, and will be forever. So then this must be right. And if that's not right, then there's none of the rest that is right. It's all either right or it is wrong.
Amen.
And you never see anybody that ever believed it and was saved but what did believe that it was right. Every divine promise is yes. And I take record of this. I believe that the right mental attitude towards any divine promise of God will bring it to pass. If you can just look at it in the way that it was written. I might not have faith enough to do that. But I certainly wouldn't stand in somebody else's way who does have faith to do it. If I can't do it and the promise is made, I'll say, God bless you, my brother. I might not be able to walk where Joshua walked. I might not be able to walk where Enoch walked, and just took a little afternoon stroll and went home with God. But I will stand in somebody else's way who can do that.
Amen.
I believe the Word is infallible. And it says He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, how can He be the same? Now, He's the same in principle, same in power, same in attitude. The only thing different is Jesus being from yesterday, if this is promised, then he had a corporal body here on earth, like we have. But that body was given for a sacrifice, raised up from the dead, set at the right hand of the Father, to make intercessions upon our confession. And then he said, a little while, and the world sees me no more. Yet ye shall see me. Now that word world means the world water, the unbeliever. They will see me no more, yet ye shall see me. That's the church, the believer. For I will be with you, even in you, to the end of the world. Christ is saying that to be there forever. St. John 15, he said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He said that about his church. He go away and be the vine, and we be the branch. Now the vine does not bear fruit. The vine only energizes the branch, and the branch bears fruit. That's right. Notice, if the vine cannot bear fruit, it's depending on its branches, and the branch cannot bear fruit until it's energized by the vine. Then if you people up here see a pumpkin vine, that pumpkin vine will bear pumpkins if the life of pumpkin is in the vine. If it's a watermelon vine, it'll bear watermelon if it's got watermelon life in it. If it's a grape vine, it'll bear grape because the life of grape is in the vine and it'll energize the branches and they'll bear grape. If the Christian church is the vine or the branches in Christ, they will do the works of Christ and bear the life of Christ.
Amen.
By their fruit you shall know them. Now, then the way that he is today is here in the form of the Holy Spirit working through his church, performing the same things that he did there.
Hallelujah.
That makes him the same yesterday, today, and forever. His life, the life that was in Christ, which was God, produced the kind of life that he lived then. That same life comes into his churches, his church members, since they have been purged by his blood and given the Holy Spirit access to work through them, bears the same fruit that he bore. So therefore the world can see then that Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, if I say to you, Methodist, what do you think about that? You say, that's true. And Jude was the only place where ever taught to contend. But he said, I earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. The Baptists, thanks they're contending for that faith. The Pentecost, thanks they're contending for that faith. The Nazarenes, thanks they're contending for that faith. And I believe it. I certainly believe it. But now let's go right down to the Bible now and find out. Now, if we can find what Jesus was yesterday, then he's got to be the same now and forever, or the Scripture's wrong.
Amen.
Now, does that sound reasonable? If we can see what he was when he was here on earth in a body, corporal body, then we can see what he would be in his body of church if he's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
True.
Now, I read tonight out of St. John. Now, let's go back in the Bible to St. John 1. And just read a few moments. And let's see what he was yesterday. Now, if we went to look for Jesus, as these Greeks did, now he wasn't a great, forceful speaker. The Scripture said in his voice as I heard in the streets and so forth. And John was a forceful speaker. John went forth as a preacher, really preaching, but doing no miracles. Christ came behind, not doing much preaching, but great miracles. And anyone that's got any spirituality can see today that that same spiritual spirit. Think of our brother Billy Graham, going forth by John, no miracles, just preaching, stirring the people.
Amen.
Now, notice, now when Jesus, after he was baptized and went out of the water and the Holy Spirit came on him, and the powers of heavens and earth was given into his hands, we find him in his fast in the wilderness, and then coming out, and immediately he began his earthly ministry. And then there was a man. Now we're thank God, when you go home tonight, or tomorrow, you women, you read that book of St. John while the revival is going on. Notice and compare it, scripture by scripture, of Jesus. Now, if Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and forever, and will manifest himself the same yesterday and forever, how many would like to see him? Let's just see your hands while you're here. I'd love to see Jesus. Well, if the scripture says we can see him, then why can't we see him? If that promise was made to us, then we've got a right to claim that promise. And if God will keep that promise, he'll keep every promise he ever made.
Amen.
Certainly he will.
Hallelujah.
Many hearts. Many of you who are not a Christian, God kept his promise. When you believe him, he saves you. Many of you have the baptism of the Spirit. And then when you believe that, maybe in the face of difficulty, but you see the scripture promises, you receive it.
Amen.
Because you believe it. Well, healing's in you also. And his promise is to you. That's right, by such you were healed. It's all settled as far as God is concerned. Jesus has paid the price. Now, in St. John 1, we find a fellow by the name of Philip and Andrew. And Andrew was Simon Peter's brother, so he went and got his brother, and his name was Simon. And he told him to come see who he found. He took him in the presence of Jesus. Let's watch the great Holy Spirit now. And as soon as he came into the presence of Jesus, Jesus said, your name is so-and-so, and you're going to be called Cephas, Peter, which is my interpretation of those stones, and your father's name is Jonas. Now you see that's a scripture. How many know that scripture? That was Jesus yesterday. As soon as this man met him, he knows who he was and who his father was. Peter later was given the key to the kingdom. Right. Then this fellow, Philip, which was of the city of Andrew and Peter, he had a good friend which was a church member. Very good man. Was looking for something to take place. He goes 30 miles around the mountain. If you're ever in Palestine, you can look it up. From where Jesus was having his revival, 30 miles around the mountain by foot, and found a fellow by the name of Nathanael, which was his buddy. And when he came up, Nathanael was under a tree praying. And he said, come see who we have found, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And we would call this without any feeling. Maybe Nathanael was a very good Presbyterian, or a Baptist, or some other denomination, Catholic. Well, he raised up and he said, now just a moment, could there be any good thing come out of Nazareth? And I think that he gave him the best answer that any man can give. He said, come see. That's the best way. Come be convinced yourself. Don't just hurry up and fill up and run out. Sit down, wait for a soul. Go back the next night. Test it out.
Amen.
Come and see. Don't sit at home and criticize. But come see for yourself. And he just made ready and started around the mountain with Philip. And on the road around, no doubt, the rock, Philip began to tell him, you know that old fisherman down there? Oh, brother Simon? Yes? You know, as soon as he got into the presence of this one from Galilee, from Nazareth, he told him what his name was. And what his father's name was. Well, it would be no mystery to me if he didn't tell you who you were when you come. See, he had seen something.
Uh-huh.
He knew what he was talking about. Uh-huh. Oh, I can imagine that they were saying,
just a moment. You probably went over on the deep end. Well, come on, he said, you go see. And on the road, when he come up into the place where Jesus was praying for the sick, he might have stood out in the audience. He might have come into the line. That I don't know. But when he come in the presence of the Lord Jesus, Jesus said, behold an Israelite in whom there is no guile. Now that was strange. Wait that up a minute. Find out, all people dressed alike. He could have been a Greek, he could have been an Arab, he could have been anything else. But Jesus said that you are an Israelite, an honest and just man. It astonished the little fellow. And he said, Rabbi, when did you know me? Well, this is your first time ever seeing me.
Hallelujah.
When did you ever know me? And Jesus said, before Philip called you, when you were under the tree, I saw you.
Hallelujah.
What eyes?
Glory.
30 miles around the mountain, I saw you under the tree. That was Jesus yesterday. If he's the same today, he's got to be the same today. And will be forever. Now notice, close. Now who was this son, Nathanael? He was an Israelite, the Jewish nation. Now, when this miracle was performed on him, he said, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. In other words, you are the Messiah that we look for. That's what the true believing Jew saw when that was performed, because he knows that was the sign of the Messiah. Many true believers know it today. Or he doesn't change. So there was a lot of people, great church members, bishops, priests, doctors, who were smart and intelligent. What did they say? They said, this man is a fortune teller.
Yeah.
Beelzebub. An evil spirit. And Jesus said, I'll forgive you for that. But when the Holy Ghost has come to do the same thing, one word against it will never be forgiven. And therefore, neither in the world that is to come. So you see where we'll be standing? In this day. The Holy Spirit will come someday and will do the same thing as one word against it. It's the unpardonable sin. Because it has called the Spirit of God an unclean spirit. Blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, that's talking about it. Calling like you call me a devil, that would be alright. You might be alright with that, God forgive you. But you call the Holy Spirit an evil thing, it's never forgiven you. You should know that.
Thank God.
Now, that's what the truth you believe, and that's what the educated and orthodox you believe. One said you are the Son of God because you did that. And the other says he's an evil spirit. He's possessed with the devil power to do that. They couldn't figure that. They had no spirituality about him. To know in the spirit, God's things are hid from the eyes of the wise and prudent. Yes, they were reading the same Bible. They couldn't recognize that to be the Spirit of God. They know all the theology. They know all the church doctrine. But they didn't know the Spirit. They didn't know the real true Scripture. And now notice, here he goes a little further. And we find him in St. John, the 4th chapter. He was going down to Jericho. But he had me go up to Samaria. Now, if you've ever been in Palestine, that's altogether different. Go way up in here in the mountains to Samaria instead of going straight down from Jerusalem to Jericho. But notice, he had me week that goes on.
We're going to find out in a few minutes why.
And he sent his disciples away about noon. And a lovely woman come up, beautiful, but for the sake of talking, we believe that she was a woman of ill fame, prostitute. And Jesus, a middle-aged man, though he was only 33 years old, yet the scripture says he looked 50. The Bible said that. You say if you're not a man over 50 years old, say you see Abraham, now we know he's got a devil. See? Probably his work made him look old. But notice, he was setting over against a law. And in Palestine and in the eastern countries, a little panoramic like that with vines seemed to be going over, and there's a well. And that place was that way. And Jesus sitting there, and this woman come out. Well, he knew she was coming. And notice, and when she started to let the pot down into the well, if you notice it's got a window there, the women all come out early. Get the water, and they talk and get the women, all we do is talk and get the water up, you know, put it on their heads and walk away with it. But this woman come out about noontime. Why? She couldn't come out with the rest of the women. She couldn't associate herself with the rest of the women. Because she was a woman of ill fame. And she had to come to the water when she didn't have to mix with the rest of the women. And Jesus sitting there, he said, woman, bring me a drink. Remember, she was not a Jew. She was a Samaritan. And there's only three races of people. Jews, Gentiles, and Samaritans. Ham, Shem, Jacob's people, from the three sons of Noah. What's on the appeal of the Pentecostal key? They're Pentecost, Jews, down to Samaritans, then up to the house of Cornelius, and from then on the Holy Spirit was just free. He opened it to those three nations of people, tribes. Notice, and this Samaritan woman come out. And he said, woman, bring me a drink. And there was a segregation like we had in the South. Said, it's not customary for you Jews to ask the Americans, but we have no dealings with each other. He said, but if you knew who you were talking to, you'd ask me for a drink. And I'd bring you water that you don't come here at all. And she said, the well's deep, and you have nothing to draw with. The conversation went on. What was Jesus doing? Contacting her spirit. So he found her trouble. And he said, don't get your husband and come here. She said, I don't have any husband. He said, you said right. Boy, you got five husbands. And the one you now live with is not yours. Watch what the woman said. Did she say, well, you're a devil? Did she say, you're a Beelzebub? Or have you got telepathy? She said, sir, these things, but who are you? And they told me the things that have done. Isn't this the Messiah?
Hallelujah.
If that was Messiah yesterday, it's the same today. It remains the same.
Hallelujah.
Certainly. And he declared himself before the Jews that way. He declared himself before the Samaritans that way. But to you, brethren, and to you, school teachers, or Sunday school teachers, and so forth, and readers of the Bible, he forbid his disciples even to go to the Gentiles. Not one time did he ever declare himself like that before the Gentiles. Why? He was leaving for this day. And the way he made himself known in that day to the Jews and to the Samaritans, if he declared himself as theology or any other way to the Gentiles, he did wrong when he acted back there that way. He's got to be the same yesterday, today, forever. Same thing. This is the Gentile time. That was the end of the Jewish generation. That was the attitude some of them felt. A few disbelieved him and called him a devil. Others believed that he was the Son of God. Those who believe him to be a devil, they got a devil's reward. But those who believe him to be the Son of God, got the Son of God's reward. And this is the day of the Gentiles. Dispensation is just about finished. God willing, this week I'm going to get into some prophecy just coming from the Holy Orient and so forth, showing you what has just taken place. We are in the end time.
Amen.
This nation is going to power before morning. And it's just as active, 90% more active than it is 10% not active. Right, we'll get into that later, because we haven't time now. Now, when Jesus went down one time across the sea, he crossed over, a little priest said, "Come to my daughter, she's laying sick." And a woman that was in menopause, and she had a blood issue for many years, she touched his garment and turned around and went back out of the audience. Jesus stopped and said, "You touched me." And every one of them denied it. But Jesus was endued with a spirit of God. He was a man himself, but he was God inwardly. You believe that?
Amen.
Today in this modern age when you try to make him just a prophet. He was not a prophet, he was the God of the prophets. A lady that belongs to a Christian Science church said to me some time ago, she said, "Mr. Ben, you try to make Jesus divine." I said, "He was divine. If he wasn't divine, he's the greatest deceiver the world ever had."
Oh, that's right.
She said, "If I'll prove to you from the scripture he wasn't divine when he accepted," I said, "Sure." She said, "In St. John 11, when he went down to the grave of Lazarus, he cried. The Bible said he wept. He could not be divine and weep." I said, "Woman, your argument is thinner than the broth made out of a shattered chicken and starved to death." I said, "You know better than that." I said, "He was wet, that's right. He was a man when he was weeping. But when he stood and straightened that little frame up and said, 'Lazarus, come forth,' and a man had been dead 4 days, come out of the grave, that was more than a man." The soul of his creator. Yes, sir. When he was come down off of the mountain one night hungry and looked around for something to eat and couldn't find nothing. He was a man when he was hungry. But when he took 5 biscuits and 2 pieces of fish and fed 5,000, that was more than a man.
Amen.
That was God, the Creator. He was a man when he was so tired, laying out down that little old ship, it tossed about like a bottle stopper. On a mighty ocean, 10,000 devils of the sea swore there drowning. He was a man when he was laying there asleep. But when he put his foot on the rail of all the devil and said, "Peace, be still," that was more than a man. He was a man when he cried for mercy at the cross. But when he broke the seals of the tomb on Easter morning and come forth, he was more than a man. He proved he was God. The word of the Lord said, "Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried my sins far away, rising, he justified, dreaming forever. Someday he's coming." Oh, glory to
him.
More than a man, God manifested his flesh. There, when that woman touched him, he looked there and said, "Who touched me?" That was the man speaking. Everybody united, but that power was in him. He found the little woman. He told her what her trouble was. He said, "Thy faith has saved thee." That was Jesus yesterday. He's the same today. Not the Old Testament, the New Testament, Hebrews says he is our high priest that can be touched by the healing of our infirmity. How would you know you touched him if he spoke back to his face? Just as he did yesterday, he'll do it today, or he isn't the same yesterday, today, and forever. We're living in the last day. Watch it in St. John 5:19. Walk through a pool. There lay great multitudes, thousands of people, laying there, lame, halt, withered, blind, waiting for the moving of the water. Here he comes, a few days after this happened. Here he walks through that crowd. There was a lame, halt, blind, withered. Walked right through them. Looked around till he found a man laying on a pallet. Now, you Southerners ought to know what a pallet is. I was raised on one.
Amen.
So I put at the door. All right, keep cool. And there, laying on this pallet, he found a man. He might have had prostate trouble. He might have had TB. Whatever it was retarded. It had it 38 years. It wasn't going to kill him. And Jesus passed all the rest of them by and went to that one man and said, "Will thou be made whole?" How many knows that's the scripture?
Amen.
That's John the 6th chapter. What? How do you know it? Because he knew he had been this way for a long time. God had showed him where to go. Now when he was questioned of it, St. John 5:19, think of it now, 5:19, when they were questioned, Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing in himself, but what he sees the Father doing." How many knows that scripture? All right. What is it? He never did one miracle, never performed one thing, until God the Father showed him what to do, and God the Father was in him. "A little while in the world will see me no more, yet ye shall see me, for I will be with you, even in you, to the end of the world. The works that I do, shall you do also." Lord, I am with you always. Jesus Christ, the same, yesterday, today, and forever. As far as healing, it's already purchased. As far as salvation, every gifted blessing that it was included for you in the atonement is yours by faith. A minister can preach the word. I'm not a preacher. The minister could preach the word, and he could make it so plain to you. He'd accept it like that. Then God's good. If you could take my word for it, that'd be enough, but not God. No, he moves every stone that can be moved to see if he can get you to believe. Then he sends his spirit into it. Sometimes it works in different ways. He sends it into it to reveal himself. And it never through the history, through the ages, but back to anywhere, has it been revealed in this manner until today. What happens? It crosses. You say, "Well, Brother Graham, that ought to mean here or there." It never even makes a newspaper. Why? It never did in the Bible time. It never did in the days of the saints. It never did. But God takes it through just the same. When it's all over, then say, "Well, I didn't know it." See, no man can come to me except my Father draws him first. That's right. True. Now, I pray, friend, that you understand that Jesus is the same as he was then. He'll work in you just like he worked in Christ in that day, God will. He'll work in any member of his body. Now, all of us can't do the same thing. Some eyes, nose, ears, you know how it is. How the scripture says, 1 Corinthians 12, some prophesy, some do one thing, some do another. But that's the gift of the Spirit working in the church, the body. And Christ has raised from the dead. Now, if he will come in this city, audible, that you can see his work doing the same as he did yesterday and that day, as I have told you, and you know that in Scripture, if that was a sign that he did to prove he was Messiah to both the Hebrews and to the Samaritans, he's obligated to do that to the Gentiles. How many know that? The Bible says he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let us pray. Lord God, great Jehovah, make thyself known tonight. We believe thee to be the infallible God, the great Elohim, the great Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, the Almighty, the Alpha, the Omega. Thou art not dead, how could God die? The tabernacle that he lived in died, but not God. He raised up that tabernacle, the body of our blessed Lord, that gave the promise, "A little while in the world won't see me no more, yet ye shall see me, for I'll be with you to the end of the world." Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Lord God, we're just men. We're just men and women. Thou art God. And perhaps there might be people here who have never seen thy great power. Yet they have walked with you. They have walked like Theotis and his friends. After the resurrection, they walked all day here with you. You talked to them, explained the scriptures to them, and they didn't know you. And no man can know God, only who the Son of God will reveal. And I pray, Heavenly Father, as Theophilus and them got you on the inside and shut the door in the little restaurant, then you opened their eyes. You did
something the way you did before you were crucified. And by that they know that you're raised from the dead. Lord God, there are many Theophiuses in here tonight. These children of yours. And they serve you, they walk with you, they talk with you, they listen to their pastors. And now, Lord, we've got the door shut and our heart door open. Open our eyes and manifest yourself. Do the things tonight that you did before your crucifixion. It'll encourage your children to keep on serving you. It'll give those who are feeble strength. It'll heal those that are sick. It'll cause the unbeliever to believe. Grant it, Father, and we'll thank thee in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, Lord, we submit ourselves unto thee, energize the body of thy servant, that we might speak, see, and hear the Lord Jesus. Amen. Just a little late, I'm sorry, because you've been waiting a long time. Tomorrow night we'll come real quick. Now, I believe Billy told me he'd give out the prayer cards. What?
Eight.
1 to 100. All right. There would be prayer cards H. It's a little square card. And it's just got, I don't think that my youth had them a picture on them, but they got a number on them and a letter. And it's got H and 1 to 100. Now we'll start somewhere along there. We can't bring too many at a time, but we'll just bring them as we can. Let's start from number one, then this is the first night. Who has prayer card H number one? Just raise up your hand, wherever it is in the building. H number one. Is it anywhere?
Right.
Well, we'll start from somewhere else. Oh, I'm sorry. All right. Number one, you come right here. Number two, would you raise your hand? H number two. Right there, you come here, lady. Number three. H number three, would you raise your hand? The lady back here, right here. That's all right. Just stand right there. Here's the further step up here. Number three. Number four. Who has number four? Let's see your hand. H number four. Prayer card. Look, it might, some of you look at your neighbor's card. It might be, or you have your hand up, lady. Is yours H number four? Or right. Watch your numbers when they're called upon. Somebody might be deaf and dumb, can't speak or hear. Somebody might be so crippled they can't stand up. Just watch the card, the people. Look. All right, number, what was it, four, five? Who has the five? All right, sister. Number six. All right, number seven. Prayer card number seven is you, lady. Eight, nine, come out here, lady, each one. Now, if you call your number, line up over here. Number nine, did I hit that one? All right, number 10, prayer card number 10, the gentleman. Number 11, all right, 12, that's it. Raise that up quickly if you can. If you can't raise your hand, somebody else come get you. 12, 13, 14, 15, prayer card number 15, would you raise your hand? All right. We like one card, 15. All right, no, she's 14. 16. Prayer card 16, all right, sir. 17. A lady, a man, or whoever might have stepped down. 17, 18. 18, all right, 19. 20. I'll leave that card as many as we stand right now, so I can get five. No, that's all right. Now, maybe if the people just even wouldn't have come up here, if they weren't here, maybe this is all right. This is all right. And you can go back home, then you can walk. If they can't walk, then you bring them up here. Now I'm about 15 minutes late to start the line. This is the first night. A lot of upsets, you know what I mean. Now I'm forced to just think preaching and it's just one meeting right at the other, right at the other, right at the other, right at the other, right at the other. It's just all kinds of weather from the north to the south. And it's not cold, it's just overtaxed body. Now, I would have asked you, how many in here that does not have a prayer card, and yet you're sick and you want God to heal you, would you raise up your hand so you just have a general confession?
Oh,
just all over everybody. Now look.
Now, if these people here, now I want to ask, how many of you in the prayer line here, it's strangers to me, I don't know you. Just raise up your hands, use the line here. Strangers. How many out there are strangers to me, I don't know? Raise up your hand, anyone. What's a solid everywhere? I don't know one person in here outside of Mr. Mercer here, Mr. Vail, and Brother Kitty here. And maybe I might go to some of those ministers. I was looking at them a lot, it would seem like I've seen them in conventions and so forth, I believe, but maybe not all of them. I can't call anyone's name, this fellow here. It seemed like I'd seen him and the girl, fellow here. Are you Brother Wilson, are you?
Yes.
I thought so. All right. That's about the limit that I would know. Now look. Now, I have just explained to you by the Bible that all healing comes from God and is already finished work. How many know that now? How many know that if Jesus, the Son of God, was standing right here with this suit on, as some of you people sent me the other day, all right, how could, if he was standing here and you come to him and said, Lord Jesus, will you heal me? Now, be careful. Could he do it? He could not. He's already done it. It was in his home, but how many know that? He was a child of mine. Don't you know I've already done it? Do you believe it? Yes, Lord, I believe it. All right. On your way, as you had believed, so be it for you. How many know that was he yet? How many know that he's already healed everybody? Everybody is home. Every gifted blessing, everything that can be done for the human race is already done. When Jesus finished the work and said, it's finished at Calvary, you know that every gifted blessing. Now, some of you ministers might not believe in divine healing. But how could you preach salvation to the soul without divine healing? What is sickness? Sickness is an attribute of sin. What is sin? Smoking? Drinking? No. Nope. Committing adultery? No. Nope. Well, what's that? That's an attribute of unbelief. What is sin? There's only one sin. That's unbelief. He that believeth not is condemned already.
Hallelujah.
Only you. Faith and unbelief. You're on one side. If you are a believer, you don't smoke, drink, and commit adultery. But because you don't do it, don't make you a believer. See? No, sir. It's just an attribute. What is sickness? Sickness is the attribute of sin. Before we had any sin, we had no sickness. Sickness came in because of sin. How many know that? Well, sure. Well, then look. If a great big animal has you and it's pawing your side, pulling the ribs out. Now, you wouldn't be necessary for you to cut that paw off if he wasn't biting you. You would have to cut his paw off, just knock him in the head. That'd kill the whole thing. Is that right? Well, that's the way sickness is. When you kill sin, you kill sickness with it. You can't preach salvation without taking everything that ever happened to the human race. He was our redeemer. Your redeemer. Yes, sir. Even this old body, when it dies, like our soul dies and our spirit is born again, we're a new creature, got eternal life. Forever, forever, we never die with eternal life. You can't. It's eternal. Zoe, God's own life. Can't die. All right. Then, when you are sick and you go and you die and go into the grave, when God comes, Christ comes, you're called from the dust. Already finished work. God calls and you rise. He don't have to come down, make an atonement, make you out, and make you another person. He just speaks and you come forth. That's right. Well, now what is this? What is salvation we have now? It is the earnest of our completeness in God, where we'll never have any more thoughts of sin. What is sickness now? What is healing of our body? It's the earnest money of our resurrection. Perfect. Now, believe. Now, and I want you now just to be just as reverent as you can be and believe with all that's in you. Don't move around. But now, when the Holy Spirit is speaking, if he does, how many seen the picture of it tonight? Let's see how many have ever seen the picture right here in Washington, D.C. We'll get it for you tomorrow night. An angel of the Lord that's right here in Washington, D.C., George J. Lacy, the head of the FBI, and I'm examining, got this signed document right here, the only supernatural being that was ever photographed in the world. Dragon from God. Just a few of them. Now, folks, we have to get them from the American Photography Association, the Douglas Studios out of Texas, where it was taken. They see in Germany a few months ago, three times they're coming, going back, the pillar of fire, the same one that followed the children of Israel,
in the days of Israel's journey. How many know it was a pillar of fire?
Right.
How many know that was right?
Yeah.
That shows your call. That's what makes it. That's good, brother.
Right.
That's right. When he was here on earth, he said, I come from God. I return to God. When he come on earth, when he was with the children of Israel, he was a pillar of fire. He's in the burning bush. Jesus, when he's on earth, he said, I am that I am was in the bush.
Right.
Is that right?
Sure.
He was. All right. Then he said, I come from that. I return to that. After his death, burial, and resurrection, Paul met him on the road down to Damascus. What was he? A light that put Paul's eyes out, standing in his prayer. Right. Now here's his picture again, right here again. I keep telling it, and George Blake, he said, I've been your critic to you, Mr. Brown, but said, I said it was psychology, but said the mechanical eye of this camera won't take psychology. That's the head of the FBI. It was absolutely there. That same angel is not 2 foot from where I'm standing now. But I'm alive. Not for me, it's for you. It's for us, the church. The believers were right in the days of the coming of the Lord. He has returned to see the sin that's gone on just like it is in Abraham's time for it, destroying Lot and so forth, or the Sodom and Gomorrah. We'll get into that later this week. We haven't time for it now. Now be real reverent. Watch, believe. Now, Lord, from henceforth it's your service. It's been yours all along. But now speak, Lord. One word from you will be more than millions from all us ministers. We are your children. We love to speak of it. But just one word from you will be more than anything we could do. Grant these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, you without your prayer card, just start saying, Lord, I believe that man told the truth because he took it from the scripture. Now, I'm touching your garment. And make it known to me tonight, myself. I can't get up there on the prayer on the line, but let him speak. If I touch you, let him speak and call me from here and tell me this. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now you start believing that. Now don't make yourself nervous. Just believe. Just let your nervousness go. Now the little lady, I suppose she's on the chair with a little on her head, your little cap. Now I suppose this is our first time meeting, is it, buddy? You saw me. It's probably in a meeting? Oh, in a meeting. In a conviction. All right. Now, of course, I have no way of knowing you or what's wrong with you or anything. You know that. I'm just a man and you're a woman. Now, here is a beautiful Bible picture being portrayed. Not in some dark corner, like the devil's trying to do, but out here where everybody can see. And God doesn't have to get in the dark corner. God's the God of life. Now, Jesus and a woman spoke to each other at the well of Samaria. And there was a man and a woman meeting first. And Jesus found out what her trouble was and told her. By that she said, you must be a prophet. That would be a servant of the Messiah. But she said, I know when the Messiah comes, we Samaritans, we know when the Messiah cometh, he'll show these signs. You believe that? In your own religion, you're taught that. She knows that, she said. All right, that's good. Now, just as a man, then if the Messiah raised from the dead, he's here in the form of the Holy Spirit. Now, if I say, lady, you're sick, you might not be. If I say, lady, you want finances, you might not. I say, lady, you're staying for somebody else, you might not. I don't know. But if I say, you're sick, and you have to hit it right, you're going to get well, you say, that's been a guess. See? But now, if the Holy Spirit will come and go back and say something that you know whether it's truth or not, you can witness that. You know that. But now, if I'm telling you something in the future, you have a right to doubt it. But if it tells you something that's in the past, you'll know whether it's the truth or not. Now, is that truth, friend? That's the miracle. Let her be the judge, and you be the judge. Now, if you're judging God, but we're loving God, and we're glad that He is raised from the dead. Now, I'm saying that I believe that He will do it. If He will just, being the first person here, if He will just make known to me your trouble as your brother, which you are a Christian, and if you would just speak through me and tell me what you're here for or something like that, you'd accept that He knows you then, and you're going to get what you ask for. You believe that? Will the rest of the audience read it with you? I see what I'm trying to find favor with the Holy Spirit. You see, the two people will believe you. See? Read the book. He said, if you get the people to believe you, I said, I'm uneducated. He said, this will be given to you. And then he told me about it in the scripture. Then it's been ever since I was a little baby boy.
thousands of times and never finish. I'd be real, real thrilled. Now, if the Lord God, if I could help you and wouldn't do it, I'd be an awful person. But I couldn't help you. But God can. Now, if the Lord will tell me what's your trouble, you're going to believe it. Now, if anybody, if they can still hear my voice in the audience, the woman's moving from me. And she is suffering with a heart trouble. That's exactly right. And that's a nervous heart. The nervous condition. And then I notice you trying to read or do something. Your eyes are going bad. That's true. And then you have a female trouble, which is a growth on the female organ. It should be operating. And so you've been told, and he said the doctor said that should be done. If that's true, raise your hand. You believe in Jesus Christ? Can I heal the woman? No. But I believe she's already healed. I believe her faith. Now, was every word, I don't know what I said to you. See the recording going there? That tells what it was. See? That was somewhere in another world, or to you scientists, another dimension. You Christians in the Spirit of God. Alright. Here's a woman. Never met her before. Whatever he told her, she's got her hands up, and it's absolutely the truth. And this is our first time ever meeting and speaking to each other in the world. What is it? Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Sir, we would see Jesus. Now, if it's your brother, you know. It can't be me. Some power knows her. Now, it depends on what you think the power is. You think it's the Holy Spirit? You get that reward. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, grant unto this dear woman the things that she has desired. I pray for this blessing to her in the name of thy Son, the Lord Jesus. Amen. I don't doubt, go and speak just exactly what you've asked for, you can receive it. Everybody be real ready. Suppose we're strangers to each other. I think you raised up your hand a few minutes ago. It's our first time meeting. The Lord Jesus knows us both. And someday we've got to stand in his presence. Now tonight, be a little nervous because it's the audience of people, wonderful people, but it begins to rise a little. You can't help it, see, when it makes a nervous tension. If I don't know you, and the Lord Jesus will tell me what you're here for, would you believe me to be his servant? Did he promise he would do that? Is there anyone in the audience knows you?
There is.
Then they'll know whether it's true or not. You'll know. Now, to heal you, I couldn't. To hide your life, you couldn't. Because it's his presence. Now, you're aware that something's going on. You know that standing before a man, your brother, wouldn't make you feel that. There's so the audience would know. You're a sane-looking person, you are. A real sweet, humble like you. Is that right? That angel of the Lord is sitting right around the woman, looking right at her. The woman wants me to pray for some condition that she has, and that is her limbs, her legs. That thus saith the Lord. Now, that's right, ladies and gentlemen. Now, see, more you would talk to her, more would be said. Now, whatever it was, I see something the woman is doing or something, whatever it was, she'd be the witness. I just talked to her a little more. See, you can't get to too many, but let's just tonight just be, take her time. Just a stitch your limbs. And also you get some kind of a condition that's in your spine. Right. It's gallbladder trouble.
Exactly.
Exactly the truth. And you're deeply distressed about someone. That's a loved one. That's your son. He's not here. He's in another city. And that place is called Roanoke. And he is suffering with a mental condition. It's called, he's a veteran, a young man, got Second World War. That's exactly right. That's thus saith the Lord.
Hallelujah.
You believe Jesus Christ knows you now? And your faith is right in his hands. You believe you will receive what you've asked for?
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Dear God, I pray that you'll be merciful to our sister and give to her these things that she wants. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now the Bible says these signs shall follow them that believe. And you go and believe it. I'll be real reverent. Don't move around, please. You see, if you do, it upsets me. I'll be real reverent. I suppose this is our first time meeting. We're strangers to each other. And probably born years apart and miles apart. Now, please don't do that, friend. Don't move. Just sit still just a minute, will you, please? I'll leave you another 5 minutes if you'll just. Now, don't move. See, you've got to be reverent in the presence of God. The Holy Spirit said to me when he met me that night, if you get the people to believe you, then you've got to do what I tell you. If you believe me to be the servant of Christ, I say just the things that he says to say. The lady and I are strangers. She's younger than I. We don't know each other. This is our first time meeting. But God knows about both of us. If he will reveal to me what your trouble is, you will believe that he is the resurrected Christ working through just his church here. You will believe. The Lord God grant you. Your trouble is a nervous condition. Then you got trouble in your chest. That is your nerves tightening you up. And you've just had some kind of an accident, or you fell on ice and hurt. That's hurt your spine. And you're a preacher, a lady preacher.
That's right. That's right.
And you got somebody on your heart that's dear to you. Somebody that's in your own congregation. It's someone that's got cancer in the last stage, and you want prayer for her. That's it. Thus saith the Lord.
Oh God.
Now the tears on the handkerchief, put it on. Lord God, grant these things as I pray and bless you, sir, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Look out. Believe what you ask. You shall receive. How do you do? You reverend. Now, ladies, you sitting there with your head down praying. Here. You touch something. I don't know, yes, you. You believe he could be Christ's servant? You do. You're wanting something from God, aren't you? The reason was this woman a few moments ago had something wrong in her chest. I saw you stand here before me. You suffer with a heart trouble. That's right. And you got a high blood pressure, too. If that's right, raise up your hand. You touch something. I've never seen you have it. You touch something, he heals you then.
Oh, wonderful.
Not out in the audience now, be real. That gives us a thrill to the woman right behind you there with the red coat on, you has a bladder trouble. That's right, baby. You believe it? God makes you well now? All right, you can have it. If you believe it. All right, that's good. The Mennonite brother there next to you there, praying also the heart trouble. You believe that God will make you well, sir? You touched him. It's over. Have faith in God. Myself, I know you not. But the Lord God does know you. Yet the Lord God, who created the heavens and earth, will reveal to me what you're standing here for. Will you believe it? You are suffering with a condition in your back, a back trouble. You have a throat trouble also. That's right. A gallbladder trouble. You're bothering. You're not from this city. No. If the Lord would tell me something about you, where you're from, would you believe with all your heart? You're trying to press into something, lady. That won't do no good. See? Won't do no good. You just believe. Just simply. Just childlike faith. You just believe. You're from a place called Madison, Virginia. Your name's Rose.
Your last name's Nichols. Now, that's true. Now, turn around and go home and believe with all your heart and be well. If thou canst believe, all things will
be. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you with all your brethren. The speed brethren. I suppose we're strangers to each other. You've been within one of me. Not old black farmer. Just sitting out the audience of it. Past five, past line. How long ago was that been?
Well, you were
in
Fort
Wayne. Oh, Fort Wayne. That's when that little blind girl was healed up there and the child was on his crippled feet and it went into who's who. That's the day there. That was back in time with Brother Bosworth and then the wonderful brother. I remember the people climbing up on the sky I used to see through the meeting. Brother Rediger's tabernacle. You know, Brother Rediger, years ago. And we're strangers to each other, exactly. I don't know you. You're passing through a line where thousands of people went through. No one would ever know. You're real reverent. Something happened. All right, now be real reverent. Just believe with all your heart. You believe that God will grant to you the things that you're asking for? Mm-hmm. You're suffering with several things. I see you've been had an operation or something. I see you going two times.
That's
you've had two operations.
That's
then you got an inward trouble, an internal trouble. And that was caused from childbirth. It's a sore. That's been many, many years ago when you was a younger woman. That's exactly. You believe that God heals you? Let us pray. All eternal God, author of life, send out blessings upon the woman and make her well, Father. I pray that you'll grant these things in the name of thy Son, Jesus. Just believe with all your heart. And as the Bible said, if thou canst believe, all things are possible. All the time. I'm getting a thought back there. Somebody thought Jesus perceived their thoughts. How many know? Ever to let ask you something. Lady, put your hand over. If God will reveal to me what's your trouble looking this way, would you believe me? All right, then your heart won't bother you no more. You can go home and be well. You can believe me. Don't get evil doubts, you see. That makes you very bad if you do that. You believe that girl, little lady, peeping around the side of that little lady said you have heart trouble too, sitting way back there, your fingers in your mouth. You believe that God made me well? If you believe it, you have it. Heart trouble also. Thou canst believe. Right back behind there also, you had heart trouble, you got a rupture too. You believe that God will make it well? Raise your hand up, Mr. Stringy. What if I told you you were healed before you come up here? Would you take my word to heart? And turn around and go back. Just before you come up, baby, just stand where you are right there, brother. Leave it there. Just right there for a minute. You believe me to be his servant?
Yes.
You're a shadow of darkness. That's dead. You got a cancer. You believe that God will heal it? Raise up your hands. I accept you, Jesus, as my healer. God bless you. Now go on your road and don't think more about it. Go on and believe with all your heart. If you can, you'll certainly believe. Just stay where you are, lady. You believe me being a servant? You believe that bad trouble is going to leave you? You'll be all right. If you do, raise up your hand. All right, you can go right around this way and you may well. Go right ahead and leave him with all your heart. You believe out there in the audience? If thou canst believe. That lets you move that trouble left the lady there. That you do, son. Go on your road and rejoice. Oh, thank you, God. Believe. You also, lady.
All right, and your back also has kidney conditions been for a long time. That's right. On your own. How many out there want to be healed? You believe that God will make you one? That man so rejoicing about being healed, that heart trouble or whatever it was a few minutes ago, the man sat next to him was all thrilled, but he had an asthmatic condition that he wanted to be healed by. You believe, sir, that God will heal you, that asthma and make you well? Sitting right back there with a man that was healed with the heart trouble? You do? Well, then you can have it. You can go on your own, rejoice and say thank you, Lord. How many want to be healed? Raise your hand. See, I've helped you too long. It's restless, the spirit. See, you're maybe got to meet brothers and things like that. I don't want to be rude, but I want you to do something for me. Lay your hands over on each other. Just put your hands over on each other. Right here, folks, we don't have much trouble. Lay your hands right here on each other. Friends, do you believe that the Son of God, who I'm trying to tell you loves you, do you believe that he's here to say amen?
Amen.
Is this what the Bible said would take place?
Amen.
Now remember, this is more than what he did when he was here. Because one person touched him and he got so weak he couldn't move. Or he could move, but he said virtue went from him, virtue strength. But he said, these things that I do shall you do also and more than this. See, we're at the end time now. That's the reason I'm weak, that's true.
That's true.
Now, it's just vision, it doesn't. Just think, that so many come through to you, you don't know which is where you're in vision or out of vision. See? It's for you. It's the Lord God that's good to you to show you. Now, friends, I don't know what more he could do. I don't know one thing more he could do. He's proved to you that he's not dead, he's alive and in here. Now, what good would be me standing here anointed if you were out there and wouldn't believe it? It takes your faith is what touches him and does these things. It isn't me. I don't operate that. You operate it with your own faith is what does it. See? It's you, not me. You. And what is it? It's showing that this a person, a man, nothing at all, I'm just a man like you, like you, man. Probably the rapture come and righteousness was declared to go first. You, every one of you, go before me. I was born out of season. A lot of you people here were preaching the gospel. But when I was just a little local Baptist pastor down there, and you stood for these things, see? It's God's goodness and mercy to you people. Believe me, friends. Believe me as your brother. I'm telling you from all my heart that it's God sent to you. Not me. I'm not God sent to you. The Holy Spirit is God's gift sent to you, see? And it's for you. And every one of you that can believe it and accept it on the basis of the resurrection of Christ and accept it, you're healed right now. Now, let us pray. And you pray for the person sitting next to you, and each one of you pray for the one sitting next to you, the way you pray in your church. If you're Baptist, pray the way the Baptist pray. If you're Pentecost, pray the way they pray. Whatever it is, just pray the way you pray for whoever who's sitting next to you that you're praying for. I'll pray for all of you. Lord God, creator of heaven.